Hi, I'm Ben Glass, also known as Digistep from Dubkasm, and I'm here at DBS Music to talk about creating an album from an initial idea. Many say war is the answer. Rastafari say peace, love and harmony. Thank you, guys. Hey, thanks a lot for coming. I hope you enjoy the talk. I've come to tell you about a major album project that I worked on a couple of years back, 2018 actually, and just talk to you a little bit about the journey of creating the album, the creative process, and how we turned a kind of an idea into a final product. The album is here. It's called Rastrumentals by us, Dubkasm. It's a gatefold double vinyl album. So I'm gonna, as I talk about the products, I'm just gonna pass them around. You can just pass them around and have a little look at them. Feel free to take the inner sleeves out, which have got graphics on them and things like that as well. So it's all about Rastrumentals today and the story behind it and what it means to me, and hopefully give you some kind of ideas and strategies about how you can be how you can make an idea turn into a final product. So it's definitely the most ambitious project I've ever done. I'm going to say me and Sam, the guy I do music with, DJ Strider, we make up Dubkasm, and it's the most ambitious project. It took us about 8 years to create the album from start to finish, and it was recorded across between Brazil and the UK. So it's I'm just going to talk through a little bit about our background, what we've done, how we reached the album, and how we reached that that project, because there's definitely quite a strong kind of evolution to the story, and play some music from the album, we'll talk about it with a little track breakdown, and that's what we're going to be doing today. So I hope you enjoy it. Any questions before we start? Is everyone all right? We're having a good day today. Yeah, cool. So yeah, turning an idea into a major project, that is our main theme today. You know when you have a really good idea and it just suddenly comes to you and you think that would be a really cool project? And I mean, how many good ideas you get and you end up not putting into practice? It happens a lot, doesn't it? Why is that? Sometimes it's because they're, too far-fetched or too ambitious, or maybe nobody else believes in the idea as well. Or, you know, sometimes we get one put down. I remember getting one put down about something and that putting me off doing a whole project, you know, when I was younger. And it can be a number of things, but that moment where you have an idea and how you could turn that into a bigger idea, that's what this whole talk is going to be about, really. How you can get an idea and develop it into something much, much bigger. So, welcome to the lecture. So, that's me, Ben Glass, on the left, and Sam Howard on the right. Sam is the other half of Dubkasm. He's my best friend, and we've known each other all our lives. Our mums met at prenatal classes when we were still unborn. And we just kind of grew up together, played together. We never lived in the same part of Bristol, but we used to see each other most weeks and weekends, and we'd go on holiday together throughout our childhood. And we kind of just got into the same music, really, during our teenage years, which was reggae and dub. Sam, particularly the reggae side and Jamaican music, he's a DJ, DJ Strider, and myself, more the kind of a dub roots, but lots of crossover. So that's me and Sam playing the sandpit. So and he's still my best friend, miraculously. You know, we've been through a lot together, and it's been a really great experience. So here's me, age 16, 15 or 16, playing with, making dub actually, in my bedroom. And what you see there is a motley collection of borrowed bits of music technology from all over the place. So you've got a Watkins copycat here, which I borrowed from my brother's guitar teacher. this graphic EQ pedal was borrowed from somebody, the mic stand, etc. But this DX11 synthesizer was kind of what got me into music technology. It's an FM synth, so a lot of you probably know about FM synthesis, and it's a relative of the DX7. The DX11 is multi-timbral, which as opposed to the DX7, in the DX11 you can layer different sounds together. So as well as being polyphonic, 8-note polyphonic, that's all you get, it's also multi-timbral, so you could choose different voices, as they're called, and layer them up to play a performance. And this synthesizer, my dad is like a bit of a wild card sometimes. He sort of like does something really spontaneous, like buys a synthesizer. When, you know, synthesizers back then were quite expensive. This was a kind of a budget, the DX11 was a kind of a budget synthesizer of the time, but even so, it was a lot of money in the like 80s. And my mum told him to take it back to the shop, and there's no way we can afford this, take it back now. And somehow he managed to convince her that it was a good idea. And it was a great idea, because that's what got me into music technology. I used to read the manual of the DX11, which was translated from Japanese, so it was terrible translations, really, really hard to decipher what it was on about. But I used to study the manual, and I taught myself how to program the synth and store the sounds on this, can you see this little RAM cartridge here? That is a RAM cartridge that you can store 32 sounds on. And it's a great synth. FM synthesis is amazing, you know. That's going into a four track here on the bottom left, a cassette based Porter Studio four track recorder. And that was another thing that got me into kind of, I used to basically turn my mum's hi-fi into a multi-tracker by recording to cassette and then dubbing from tape to another tape, so recording from one tape to another tape, and then playing stuff over the top as it was bouncing from one tape to the other. And then I would get that tape and play that tape to another tape and then record. So I kind of wired my mum's hi-fi in a way that I could do multi-tracking. And once I realized that was not sustainable, I decided to save up for a four-track, and this was the first piece of music equipment I got. This is the MT-120. You can't really see it very well, I'm afraid, but it's a cassette-based four-track Porter Studio. And so that's me. And the reason I wanted to put that photograph is because it kind of embodies to me that kind of like passion that I have for creating music and music technology and just being creative with weird bits of gear and so on. And the feeling I had back then, I still have that feeling now, and I hope that I'll carry on having that feeling, because it's that excitement that kind of keeps me going, you know. So when I talk to students and stuff about this kind of thing, I still have that excitement that I had back then, you know, and I try to sustain that. So we formed Dubkasm in about 1994 when we were sort of in our early teens, and I think I came up with the name Dubkasm, originally spelt Dubchasm, which is the correct spelling of chasm, but lots of people used to say Dubchasm, so we changed it to a K-A-S-M. Yep, we dumbed it down. And this was when I was at uni. We had a night at the Undercroft bar, which is the student bar at uni, and Sam came up from Bristol to London, and he played loads of vinyl, and I had my synthesizer, I think, just doing siren sounds going through an echo pedal incessantly, like complete overkill. And but my favorite part of this flyer is 8 p.m. till told to switch off. So that was our first ever gig, 1997. And here we are now, me and Sam. This is us doing a gig in Boomtown Fair a few years back on the Lion's Den stage. So we've been lucky enough to, we're kind of stuck at it really. You know, we started making music in our teens, and when we were teenagers, dub was definitely not like a cool genre to be making. Nobody was really into it. It was, you know, obviously you had the underground, the sound system scene, but even then it was quite dead at that time. There was no real buzz about it. I remember going to like house parties and I'd take a cassette of Scientist or something and play this music, and people just say like, it all sounds the same, you know, and it's, and so it just wasn't like, it just wasn't happening for people. But one thing I do always say is that like, we just, I've just always loved it. So we stuck at it for many, many years before having any form of success really. You know, we had our tracks played by kind of the leading sound systems like Jashaka, Abashanti, Iration Steppers, for years before we were even sort of known. But we just carried on doing it because we loved it, you know, and I think that's what it's all about really. You know, you might be making a weird genre that nobody else likes, but I always feel that if that's your passion and you know, and that's your thing, then you should stick at it because, you know, what goes around comes around, and we just carried on making dub, and eventually dub became quite popular. Now you get festivals that are, you know, tens of thousands of people going to a dub festival. I mean, in the 90s, to say that would just be unheard of, you know, it just didn't happen. So anyway, that's us playing live. So 2003, we created our own record label to start putting out our own music, Software Choice Recordings. And then that later became Dubkasm Records. Here's a couple of our labels. And the news at the moment is we've just had two releases on Deep Medi Music, Mala's record label. So they put out an egoless remix of one of our tracks, which is going quite well. And this, tomorrow actually, no, today, is they're releasing a track of our own called, it's the remix of a track called Dread by Khan, the Dubkasm remix of Dread. And so we've just had two releases on Medi, and that's going really well. It's really exciting. And they even got the Medi heads. I don't know if you're familiar with the cartoon heads that they have on the labels. That's our little caricature. So I've probably said quite a bit of this already, but like I said, we formed in 94 with my best friend. We set up the indie label in 2003. We've had 29 vinyl releases to date. We've had releases with Mala, Abashanti, Kongonati, Iration Steppers, etc. Gigged in over 50 foreign cities across 24 countries. So we've done a lot of touring in some very far-flung spots. Toured in Japan, New York, Canada, Brazil, Russia, and Siberia. And we had one very successful tune, Victory, which was the best-selling reggae vinyl release in the last decade, apparently. And that was a kind of a crazy experience. We made a track. It was played by sound systems, only by Abashanti, actually, who was one of the leading sound systems, and ourselves for a couple of years on dubplate. So if you're not familiar with dubplate, it's a 10-inch, normally, acetate disc, which is a one-off pressing of a track. So the idea of dubplate exclusivity is that only you have that version of that song on that plate. So there's only one of them cut. And that's quite prevalent in dubstep now as well. And other genres, they'll do a dubplate, which is a one-off exclusive version. So when we play out live, we play dubplates. And Victory was a dubplate for a very long time. And Abashanti ran it, and there was a lot of demand for it, but we deliberately didn't release it for a long time, several years. And then when we did release it, it sold out overnight and just went completely nuts. And every time we repress it, we just keep selling. It's crazy. It's probably sold about 6,000 or 7,000 copies of it, which is unheard of nowadays for like a reggae single. And finally, we've done things like Red Bull Music, Boiler Room. It's called Boiler Room, isn't it? Not rooms. Room. Glastonbury and Outlook Festivals. So that's some of the things we've done. So what we're going to be talking about today is, like I said, the album. And how it went from a small idea into a major project. I'm going to show you a few images that are very kind of like personal and closely related to the album. First of all, this is from a school project. These are some very old photographs where my grandfather stayed with a Brazilian tribe of Indians in the Amazon region. He lived in a circular hut with a space in the very center, not in the center, in the very center. This settlement was surrounded by lots of banana leaves to keep the vampire bats out. You can see this in the top right-hand photo. The Indians were quite small. Inside their ring-like huts at night, they all slept in thick hammocks over a small fire each. Sometimes they had some rather nasty accidents because they hardly wore any clothing. Showing where they hang banana leaves around their circular hut to keep vampire bats out. And there is a diagram. Please note, the hammocks were not exactly over the fire, about 3 inches above. So this was a school project I did in around 1985, when I would have been about 8 years old. And I was fascinated by Brazil and Brazilian music. So my dad was born in Brazil. My grandmother was Brazilian and my grandfather was English. And my dad was born in a city called Niterói, which is here. And he grew up in Brazil and he moved to England when he was 16 years old. And he brought very little stuff with him. You know, the one thing that he did collect was vinyl. And I brought a couple of his records that he passed on to me. This is a great record. It's called Os Maiores Samba Enredos de Todos os Tempos, which means the best sambas of all time. And so I grew up hearing a lot of this kind of music. I'll put this on so we can hear a little bit of atmosphere. So when my dad was about 15, he went on a road trip with his best friend and they hitchhiked 2,500 miles across Brazil, and just backpacking, hitchhiking, and they had sort of like hardly any money with them. They just sort of people just putting them up in their back rooms and feeding them and things like that. And this is the diary that you're looking at there. This is his journal that he kept with a kind of the route that he took from Rio to Petrópolis, Três Rios, João de Fora, Belo Horizonte, Maracatu, Brasília. So he ended up in Brasília, the capital. And it's Charles and Ian, 18 days they traveled for. And this is a little news article that he stuck inside. So as he was going, he kind of used like a scrapbook and stuck things that he'd found in his scrapbook. And this is a news article about a festival that was going on. This is an original map of the route he took from down in Rio all the way up to São João del Rei. So my dad, Charles, was always really into music, and like I said, played vinyl like this, you know, while I was a kid, and all of that, you know, we absorb all that, don't we? You know, when I heard the music, I never used to understand the lyrics, but I do now speak fluent Portuguese. So records that I used to hear back then, I hear now, and I can understand the lyrics and the message now, which is really kind of meaningful. The reason I showed you these images is it's kind of a bit of a backdrop to why I wanted to embed the Brazilian side to the album Rastrumentals. for example, even in the graphical representation on the album, you have, I'm going to pass this around and you can have a look at the gatefold, and also the inner sleeves are printed as well. So I'm just going to pass it around just in your own time, no rush. Just help yourself and have a look at it. The gatefold includes a lot of sort of small images that kind of tell a story. And this is one of them, which is the inside of my own guitar. And I bought this guitar. It's from 1920. So it's a really old guitar, beautiful guitar. And you can see just about here that the actual price tag, the price label, is actually in Hays, which is the older currency from that period. And it's 1,000 Hays. And this is, Casa Sotero is the name of the shop that manufactured it. And they sell pianos, music, strings, accessories, records, radio, typewriters, calculators, and tapes. And yeah, that was what, I just love that label, so I included that as well. And here's my dad, me giving him a copy of Rastrumentals. So I hope that visually gives you a little flavor of where I'm coming from with that. I want to show you where the idea for Rastrumentals came from, and it was from a track on a previous album. So in 2009 we released an album called Transform I, which also has a gatefold sleeve. I can pass that one around as well in a minute. Whenever you've got time, help yourself. And Transform I was also the first album, I mean, it's been cited as the first album to actually mix Brazilian music with dub reggae. People say that, you know, it was kind of quite original in that sense. And certainly it was an idea I had, because I was living in Brazil. So I lived in Brazil for 5 years and we worked long distance, Sam and I, during that period. So we'd already set up a record label and so on. I moved to Brazil, and during that period we had to do everything remotely, so sending files over the internet, and we carried on releasing records, but everything was done through sending files. And it was incredibly slow process, because in Brazil, where we were living, the only way you could access the internet, it was so remote, was by using this kind of dongle that you stuck in the side of your laptop. There was no internet or Wi-Fi connection in the town we were living in. It was so small. We had to be super resourceful during that time in terms of making music, and the musicians that I was living with. So I was playing a lot of Brazilian music out there as well. I'm a saxophonist, and I've always played lots of Brazilian music. So I was playing in a band and a couple of small bands and ensembles playing Brazilian stuff. And that was obviously an influence as well. So I wanted to bring some of that into our Dubkasm music. So recorded some Brazilian percussion and instrumentation on our first album, Transform I, which is this one here, Transform I, 2009. And one of the tracks on the album was drastically more Brazilian than all of the others. The others were a little bit tentative, so we included a few like bits of percussion and stuff, but nothing very strident. One of the tracks was a complete kind of reimagining of one of our tunes, which is a track called Moses, featuring Russ B. Russ B, actually, coincidentally, is the same singer on Rastrumentals that does the spoken word on Rastrumentals. I'll play you the original track, and then I'll play you the Brazilianized version. This was released in 2005. This was on single. And this is the original track. It's called Moses. It's a 10-inch single. There's a 500 pressing, so it's quite a limited run. And this is what Moses originally sounded like, and then I'm going to play you the Brazilian version. I'll just play a bit of it for you to get a feel.
Yes, let there be breeze. East, west, north, and south. Oh! Rastafari, King Celestia, Almighty God. We have the chance, so we sing. Moses, Moses, Moses are the fire burning. Moses are the fire burning over here. Moses, Moses, Moses are the fire burning. Moses are the fire burning over here. Speak on, Moses, speak on. Work on, speak up. I must shadow to that land. I must shadow to that land. I must shadow to that land where I am from. Where I am from. For there is love in my heart, joy and happiness.
So that's your original. That was put out on 10 inch as a single, and it did all right. It was just, you know, it was a limited run, but it's a kind of an unusual track because it's Rasbi, the singer on it. He's actually a Nyabingi elder, so he's almost like a kind of a Rasta priest. He's from Bristol, originally from Jamaica, and he runs the Rastafarian headquarters in St. Paul's. On City Road, and he's a phenomenal person. He's like a one-off. You'll never meet anyone quite like him. He's for starters, he's got this incredible glow about him. You know, you meet him and he's just got this sort of like enlightened vibe about everything. You know, he could be going through the worst things and he still has this kind of incredible positivity, and everyone feels that meets him, you know. And he maintains this very kind of orthodox cultural liberty, as he would call it, which is a way of life, a Rastafarian way of saying living, the way you live your life. And his whole family is Rastafarian and wears, you know, African garments when they're doing their Nyabingi sessions. And he's actually the key holder for the for the former residence of Haile Selassie, which is in Bath, which is now a kind of a cultural, the building that he used to live in when he was exiled in England, is kept going today. And he's the guy that looks after it and maintains that that place. And so he's got a very deep involvement, but he's not really a musician. He's a Nyabingi chanter, which means Rastas have a Nyabingi gathering, which is percussion, drums, big drums, you have things like the repeater drum, the funde, the kete drum, and they're all African drums really, but its tradition comes from Jamaica, Rastafarian drumming, Nyabingi. And he leads the Nyabingi sessions at the Rasta HQ and other places, and he has this way of singing and presenting and chanting. He's not really a vocalist, he's not a singer. He actually sung that over a completely different song in a minor key. And I got the band to actually rewrote the whole arrangement of the song to fit around his song. So it fitted the key changes. So it's kind of like this song, I think it's probably the most evolved song over many versions I've ever done. So I'm gonna play you the Brazilian version now. So fast forward to sort of like 10 years or whatever, I'm living in a remote seaside town in Brazil called Trancoso, and producing an album, Transformai. And I invited my friend over to to add some Brazilian percussion, or two of my friends actually, over the original Moses song that Rasby was on, but to take away all of the original reggae drums and have the Brazilian percussion as the backbone. And the reason I'm focusing on this track is this track was the seed that was planted that gave rise to Rastrumentals. This track was like the pilot, or the kind of, what's the word, like the blueprint for the album. So this is the Brazilian version. So I hope you enjoy that. That was Moses from Transform I, the album. And like several years later, I started thinking that would be a great project to actually explicitly do an album where you explore that more. Because Transform I was very much, we had small Brazilian elements kind of imparted on the music, but essentially it was a very much a roots reggae dub album. And my thought was, well, what if you made a whole album of that music, you know? And that was the idea that kind of like lit the fuse for Rastrumentals. So that's why I wanted to play that track as a precursor. So what did I do? There's something that somebody once told me about Brazilians, which I think is really apt. I was probably talking about it because of the whole English pessimistic thing, you know, how we're like, oh, it's raining, brilliant, you know, that kind of attitude we have of celebrating when everything goes wrong a little bit here, maybe compared with other cultures. And my wife's Brazilian as well, and so I think she kind of like helped me see that a little bit more in myself, in terms of seeing the negative rather than the positive. And, you know, it's part of our British psyche, isn't it? You know, complaining and the weather and just like, I mean, you've only got to look at our heroes, you know, like our comedy heroes. Often they're kind of like losers or they've flopped it. And, you know, it's not like the American hero. We kind of like almost celebrate failure at times. Am I wrong? Is that, no? A little bit? And Brazilians are very much the opposite of that, okay? So, you know, life is so hard out there in so many different ways. And I saw that firsthand living there as a Brazilian, really. I wasn't living in a kind of you know, Rio, which has got everything, or São Paulo, which is like culturally expansive. I was living in a normal kind of Brazilian town doing normal jobs. And you know, it was hard. I don't know how we even made ends meet, to be honest, for a lot of the time. But what somebody said to me once was, in Brazil, you know, the sufferation and the difficulties that people face, it means that when something good happens, like even if it's a tiny, tiny, really, really small good thing, they will expand that into something colossal, you know? So, you know, amidst all the difficulties, something small and positive, that, and the perfect example of that is the Brazilian carnival, okay? So originally that was just a small street celebration, you know? People singing songs about Brazilian heritage and playing drums and having a little party, you know, which, and that became expanded into like the biggest party on earth kind of thing. So I think that's definitely a Brazilian trait. And I just like thinking of things in that way. So on a musical level, you could view that as like homing in on a small thing that you think is great and then developing that massively, you know? And that's true of things when things don't go, things go wrong, you know. Sometimes, as I'm sure a lot of you know, like, you know, happy mistake. So for example, you do something which was supposed to be, which comes across as an error, but actually if you, you know, amplify that or make it into a feature, that can be a really good thing creatively. Has anyone ever had that before? Tell me an example of when that's happened. Anyone? Hi. Yeah. So deliberately bad. Yeah, that's good. I was talking to a student today about this, about getting a kind of a piano sound that made it sound like it was, you know, a sample of an old record. And it's not that easy. I mean, there are ways of doing it, but probably the easiest way is to record it onto a cassette tape and then record it off cassette. Because, you know, the sounds that we're offered nowadays are so pristine, aren't they? You know, they're that everything, the stereo field is perfect, and the, you know, the frequency makeup of the sound is perfect. And so, yeah, like you said, imperfections, even things like tape hiss, you know, adding tape hiss to things adds another layer of reality to it. You know, there's no such thing as complete silence. And I've told this anecdote before, but John Cage, he wrote a book about silence, and as part of the research he went into an anechoic chamber. Do we know what an anechoic chamber is? Like completely soundproofed room with acoustic isolation, 360 degrees, so above and below. And has anyone ever been in an anechoic chamber here? Anyone? Yeah, Will, what's it like?
Unsettling.
Yeah, it's said that like you can go crazy in an anechoic chamber because it's so weird and different from your reality. But anyway, my original point, you know, John Cage went to the anechoic chamber at Harvard University, and he was expecting to hear, you know, complete silence for the first time. But actually he heard two very distinct frequencies in the silence, and one of them was a very high-pitched frequency and one's a very low-pitched frequency. And the high frequency was the sound of his nervous system operating, and the low frequency was the sound of his blood circulating around his body. So two audible frequencies, even in the most silent environment, you know, there's still noise. And so, you know, adding imperfections can often be good. Adding a layer of noise to something can make it sound more like real life. But anyway, that's a side note, really. Making an insignificant element into a major one. So you might make a track and something comes up, you know? Maybe something malfunctions, or you use a sound that you would never normally use. You might even think it's like a tacky sound or a rubbish sound, but for some reason this works. That might end up being the main feature of your track. And allowing a track to a creation to evolve. So, you know, it's quite hard to let go of tracks and projects sometimes, because we think we've got it the way we want it to be, and we finalize it and that's it. And especially nowadays, I mean, things are so easy to change. So if you're working on a project in the door, you can easily do a new bounce, can't you? So, oh, you listen to it 2 weeks later and you hear that one element's a bit too loud. I'll just rebounce it, and you rebounce it. And so there's not so much committal nowadays to final medium, you know. It's not like recording to tape. I mean, the original recordings, you had to get the band in the room and record to a, you know, wax cylinder or a phonograph or an early cassette tape recorder, and that was your take. There was no editing, nothing, you know. And it's kind of the opposite of that now. But allowing something to evolve is really good, you know, like giving it to other people to remix or reinventing it or doing different versions. And I'm sure, I know you know that anyway, but it's worth considering. And moving out of your comfort zone. So one of the, that last track was definitely the most Brazilian sounding track on the album. I mean, if I just, to contrast that, there are tracks like this on it. So it wasn't all upbeat, you know, Brazilian stuff. There was all kinds of different flavors on that album. So definitely a big contrast there. That's even on the same side as of the record, you know, which is quite drastic. And we got a review of that album, I think, in Wire Mag or something, and they said something like, they use the expression, not to describe it, but it's normally when you hear things about projects like mixing Brazilian music with reggae, you imagine world music horrors. That was the expression they used, world music horrors. And that expression like echoes in my mind, you know. So it's really hard to like do something like that without being slated by, you know, like there's a huge kind of public out there that just love slating things. So, and the media as well, journalists. For example, I'll give you an example. We played Boiler Room a couple of years back on the Deep Medi Boiler Room takeover. And we did a set, and when we play, I play saxophone live. And, you know, we always do that, but it's not exactly very Boiler Room. Boiler Room is normally DJ mixing and so on. And apparently, I found this out afterwards, that in the middle of the set, like the main guy who runs Boiler Room's got a phone call, an urgent phone call in the middle of our set saying, there's a guy with a saxophone, you know, because then he was just really worried that it would just be like some horrendous, I don't know, cheesy, God knows. But anyway, he said, it's fine. It was okay, you know. Oh my goodness, it's a real instrument. Do you know what I mean? It's like that attitude of like, it's like, I mean, the saxophone can be massively uncool. It's not the coolest instrument. But it depends how you play it, doesn't it? You know, if I went on and did, okay, but you know, well, I don't know what they're expecting. But my point is, it's very easy to slate other genres of music, you know, especially if you're in that kind of elite world. So that's kind of what we did with Moses, expanded an idea from a small idea into something bigger, and to make that record. And Rastrumentals was a kind of, an expansion again of that idea. So Partido Alto is a great genre of music. And I wrote my dissertation about the history of Partido Alto, actually. And it's an improvised form of samba, where people sing a chorus together, and then individuals will improvise a verse. So it's quite a tried and tested, that happens in quite a few genres of music. You have a chorus, and then you'll make up a little verse about a topic, and that's partially the out. And I'm going to show you a little film of this guy doing some partially the out. And look out for the plate scraping, because that's going to come up in a minute.
E da mangueira tem partido que diz assim. Quem mandou duvidar, quem mandou duvidar, quem mandou duvidar,
quem mandou duvidar,
quem mandou duvidar outra vez.
Quem mandou duvidar, quem mandou, quem mandou duvidar.
Meu amigo camarada, o Tantinha vai falar, quem mandou duvidar. Agora é o Osmar, quem mandou duvidar,
quem mandou duvidar.
So that's partido alto, and that's a samba de roda. Samba de roda, roda just means a circle. And you'll see it everywhere in Brazil. It's a circle of people. They'll get around on chairs or standing up and just have a jam session in the street like they're doing there. That's why it's called a roda. And, you know, Brazilian folk instruments are, the plate scraping, for example, is a classic DIY percussion type thing. Brazilians are very resourceful, so they'll turn all kinds of like odd objects into instruments or makeshift. They'll repurpose things, and the plate is it's just got a great sound, and that's what made me want to include plate scraping on the album, which I did, which I'll get to in a second. This is Juninho Freitas is a friend of mine who I met while I was in Brazil, and he's an amazing musician, arranger and composer, and he's composed numerous sambas for the carnival. So composers will get their songs put into competitions, and then winning songs will get played at the carnival, you know, the Brazilian enredos, as they're called, which is the big performance. And so this was one of the little teasers, the Instagram teasers we put out before the album came out. And it's just I recorded him a voice memo message on his phone sent via WhatsApp, and some footage that I had of him playing.
Samba é tudo na minha vida. É muito mais do que notas, do que divisão, muito mais do que a síncopa. O samba é um estilo de vida, é um modo de viver. Viver alegre, viver contente. Independente das dificuldades que a gente encontra no mundo, no cotidiano, né? Você olhar pra frente e... é chutar a bola pra frente, é continuar o jogo, independente do resultado.
So that was one of the small teasers we put out. Juninho is he did all of the arranging of the instruments as well. So while I sent him the backing tracks that had recorded in England for Rastrumentals, and he did the overdubs in Brazil and sent the files back to me in England, and I added those to the recordings here and so on. So it was kind of the opposite of what I was doing when I was living in Brazil, really. One of the hardest things is how do you blend styles and integrate different styles in a kind of an aesthetically pleasing way, or in a way that is not world music horrors, you know, like the expression I said before. You know, I'm not an expert at like dubstep and electronic production. I've worked with lots of other producers, like Mala, for example. He would approach things from a completely different way than I would. But we've all got our strengths. But if I tried to make a track in the style of Mala, it would probably be the boiler room people that would be like, the guy's full of saxophone. They would probably think it was, they'd slate it, you know. And I probably wouldn't do a very good job of it. So what I'm getting at is integrating characteristics from one genre into another, it's very important to choose what, pick your tools and what your sound. So it would be quite easy for me to do a samba remix of a track by going onto a samba sample library and getting a, you know, the full bateria, which is the samba school all playing together, the percussion together, and get a loop of that and then superimpose it on my track in the same BPM. Samba remix, you know. But immediately that's going to sound like a caricature, you know. So pick your detail. An example being the plate scraping. Okay, so the plate scraping from the Partido Alto that you just saw a minute ago was something that I've always loved and is extremely Brazilian. You know, that sound is very, very much, it's very samba, but it's particularly very samba de raiz, which means roots samba. So the earliest forms of samba is samba de raiz. And the typical formation was the plate scraping, cavaquinho, which is the little guitar, looks a bit like a ukulele, and pandeiro, which is like a tambourine. That would be your typical instrumentation. So I kind of homed in on that sound. Instead of getting a samba ensemble of samba percussionists, I wanted to home in on that sound and other things that evoked a feel of samba without screaming, this is a samba version. Does that make sense? So avoiding caricatures, and go back to the roots. So yeah, rather than just listening to, I mean, if you listen to the samba that's being produced nowadays, contemporary samba, it's completely different to what we've just seen, you know. It's more poppy. Some of the instrumentation is still there. It's even got a different name, and pagode they call it nowadays. It's kind of slow, romantic lyrics. I mean, there are lots of different kinds of samba, but the most popular form of samba in Brazil is pagode, and pagode is kind of melancholic love songs over a kind of a fairly slow samba beat and quite cheesy production. So I would, you know, go for something that the origins of that style of music. Can anyone give me an example of a different genre of music? I mean, not like the Amen Break is an epic sort of classic part of D&B. Can anyone give me another example of something that comes from the origins of a sound that's like a kind of a timeless sound or element in a genre? Does that make sense? Can anyone give me an example?
Spoken vocals on house tracks.
Yeah.
With the big relaxed, not really singing, not really speaking.
That's a good example, actually, because that's something that's easy to achieve, to re-record, but it's like a nod, isn't it? So that's a good example. If you recreated that on a new production, it's, you're kind of evoking old records that might be kind of residing in our minds, you know, like records that you've heard all your life, maybe that you've even heard your parents playing and stuff. It's all there in the back of your mind. Have you ever heard a song that you used to listen to like 10 years ago and you remember, well, you know, even if you're older like me, you hear songs you haven't heard for 30 years and you remember all the lyrics, you know, and because it just gets so embedded. And on a slightly side note, I one of the jobs I do is I work with in dementia care homes with people with Alzheimer's, and I work with them and play music from their era, and music, because it lights up so many areas of the brain, it's one of the last things that we forget. And it's sort of stored across multiple areas of the brain, unlike most things, which is why, you know, even though we might forget family members' names and faces, you'll still remember lyrics, because it's so deeply embedded. And, you know, I often surprise myself when I hear a song that I used to listen to when I was 10 years old, and I remember all the lyrics. But that's slightly off topic. But yeah, going back to the roots, and often, I mean, like I played you the Brazilian record, the whole project has this kind of connection with my childhood as well, because I grew up listening to those vinyl albums of Brazilian music. Finally, move out of your comfort zone. So yeah, move into the world music horror zone, you know, or not. So I hope that's interesting so far. I wanted to show you one of the tracks on Rastrumentals, the first track actually. And it's called Echo do Jongo. Jongo is the one of the earliest forms of music that was truly Brazilian. It was the precursor of samba. Samba grew out of jongo, and the instrumentation was very specific. I talked to Juninho about this, Juninho, my friend, and he incorporated that into this track. So Echo do Jongo means the echo of jongo. So it's like an echo harking back to that pre-samba origins of jongo. So I'm going to play it to you off vinyl, first of all. It's the opening track of the album as well, which is quite significant. Programming an album is quite a tricky thing, because you need to decide, don't you, what your opening track is. Even an EP, actually deciding, are you going to go in with something really impactful, or are you going to go in something a little bit more thought-provoking? You know, the first track on an album or EP is really important, isn't it? And so it was a tough call to decide whether to actually include that. I think I might need to borrow the vinyl back from you guys. I thought I had the actual... Oh, thanks, Will. Nice one. Thanks, man. So this is Echo do Jongo. This track features Raspy, the same guy I was talking about earlier on the spoken word. It was originally recorded, the reason it's called palco up here on screen is that when I lived in Brazil, I used to play saxophone live quite a lot, and I started playing solo. And in order to play solo, I used to record backing tracks with other Brazilian friends, musicians, and we would record, you know, a bit of percussion and guitar and so on. And when I would play out live, I would play it on my Genelec speaker and play saxophone over the top as a kind of an accompaniment backing track. And one of the tracks was called Palco. It's a song by Gilberto Gil, and I recorded a backing track for Palco, and the percussion from that was originally used on this track. That was the impetus for creating the track. And later that percussion was removed and all of this new stuff was added. But it stems right back to, you know, recording down the road in this guy's house in the middle of the forest with a couple of really terrible microphones. I didn't have very good microphones while I was out in Brazil. And it was just this guy, and he played... He had kind of a drum kit, but he had it kind of behind him, a bit like a one-man band. So he had a pedal that he would hit the bass drum behind him and do percussion at the same time. And that was where the song originated from. But then I did overdub, so I played that, but then got the drums overdubbed. But let's have a little listen to it anyway. The reason I chose this song is that you can kind of explicitly separate what makes it Brazilian and what makes it reggae and what makes it Nyabingi. So remember, I talked about Nyabingi, the Nyabingi gatherings, the Raspi, the Rastafarian community coming together to do drums and singing chants. I'll show you what a Nyabingi sounds like. This is what Nyabingi drumming sounds like.
Mm-hmm.
So my vision with Rastrumentals was to bring together Nyabingi drumming with samba, but in the context of a roots reggae album. And so we recorded those Nyabingi drums in London with some very, very good players, friends of mine, who have grown up with that in their blood, you know? And this is quite a kind of quirky track because essentially, Nyabingi is just drumming and singing. But there were some records in the 70s by people like Light of Saba, where the Mystical Revelation of Rastafari, Count Ozzy, where they would release these crazy albums of Nyabingi drumming, but with instrumentation as well. So it would have things like double bass and flute and horns and spoken word and just really psychedelic albums. They're amazing albums. You should check them out. I'll write down some names for you. But if you look up Light of Saba, I guess this is kind of the kind of vibe I was going for. So as well as the Nyabingi, we had a double bass. And also the horns and the flute is the other very kind of characteristic sound you get. That's kind of sounding a bit like a Light of Saba record, but then you have the Brazilian percussion mixed in. This is what we've got, the Brazilian percussion. Cavaquinho guitar that I was talking about. The same you saw in the video, the guy playing the little guitar, that's the cavaquinho. So the cavaquinho and the plate scraping, I don't know if you heard the plate there, the chicky chicky chicky, that's your plate scraping. And kind of blend all those. I'm going to play it off vinyl now, the actual album version, so you can hear the final track.
Together we stand while we fall. Unity is strong. stronger than the big jam. So get together.
So that's kind of where the track ended up. It's the sonics of those old 70s records with Brazilian instrumentation, but it's kind of very specifically picked Brazilian elements, you know? So we went for the cavaquinho, and we went for the plate scraping. They were just kind of strategic sounds that were evocative and meaningful. Without just trying to make it sound Brazilian by adding a do-go-do-go-do, you know, that type of thing. Does that make sense? So I don't want to go too deep in the track breakdown, because there's a lot more I want to show you and talk about. But I thought it was interesting to actually look at the kind of three different elements. There's not even really that much. There's no reggae drumming here. The bass line isn't really reggae. So essentially, it's a Nyabingi meets samba track. I mean, you have other tracks on the album, which, like, I'll just touch this one, which are much more classic reggae kind of territory. This is track two. So you can hear we opened with, it was a slightly daring move to open with the most alternative track of the whole album. The other tracks have got a lot more reggae influences, but we essentially open with kind of the most out there track. And it's a very long track. It evolves through different sections. There are lots of different musicians come in and do solos. Those old tracks by Light of Saba were like that. They were sort of like 10 minutes long, and they would have all sorts of weird instrumentation, just be kind of like quite sort of evolving, and that's what we wanted to open. So it was a big statement to open the album with that. You know, when you're putting together an EP or an album, people often open with the banger, you know, and that's a good way to work. There's nothing wrong with that. It means that people will, I mean, if I give you an example of one of these albums, these dub albums, I bought a load of albums from my collection, actually. You know, guarantee that track one on side A, this album by Prince Jammy and King Tubby, it needs to grab you. So this is nothing new. This has been going on for, you know, even the 70s, they had to grab you with the first track of the album. So you're in the record shop, you're listening to a load of albums, and then you put this on, and this is the first track. It's got to grab you. I don't know, to me, amazing opening to an album. I would hear that and I'd be like, whoa, that is an incredible dub album. I would buy the album. I mean, that there are others that are more extreme, but, you know, normally you'll put the killer track first. And in a sense, we put the kind of most challenging track first deliberately. Anyway, I just want to, just going back to the actual product, the Rastrumentals as a product, I've told you about the inspiration for the musical side of things. We also wanted the sleeves to reflect a kind of an era, because, you know, my dad was, he moved to England in the 70s. And in fact, I'll if you don't mind, I don't know, maybe some of you read it, but there's a little blurb here on the inside, and it says, the recording sessions for Rastrumentals took place over 7 years between São Paulo, Brazil, Bristol and Brixton, but the roots of the project stretch back to the arrival of Digistep's father, Charles, in 1970s Bristol. Age 18, he had nothing to his name apart from his guitar and the treasured vinyl collection he brought with him on the boat from Rio de Janeiro. He came by boat. I mean, that's pretty nuts. These records by the likes of Gilamando Reis, Paulinho da Viola and Milton Nascimento are now rare classics and sit pride of place in the Dubkasm collection. They've been invaluable in shaping Strider and Digistep's unique sound, and this LP combines their influence with the work of some of the UK's greatest reggae musicians. All of them are old friends of the band, including Blood Shanty and the unique singer, blah, 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 blah. Rastrumentals brings together the talents of 19 musicians across two continents, combining the rhythmic virtuosity of samba jihais with the propulsive horns and bass lines of roots reggae. It's an unstoppable combination and a highlight of two of the world's greatest musical traditions, Paul Lee. So a guy called Paul wrote that. But that gives you a little bit of a background, the kind of my dad arriving in England in the 70s it's a true story, you know, and we wanted to kind of reflect that. These are like 60s and 70s albums. When we were planning the sleeve, we kind of looked at these, and these were kind of what we imagined. You know, the fonts, the space, the types of photos. The cover ended up being this. And we wanted to do a lot of sort of details as well. So the icon, the stereo icon, we actually got a Portuguese one. So it says som estereofónico, stereophonic sound in Portuguese. Just little details like that. a little bit about how we picked the imagery and things like that, and how we created the visuals. Rasp B, we took some photographs in the studio. These are all the shots our friend took. And this photo we went with because it felt it really captured his energy and his personality. And that's the one that you see in the front cover. So we picked that, put it in black and white. And the gatefold, the inside, you probably saw the gatefold inside. That's actually something we built ourselves, the two boxes on the gatefold. We built the story of the record into a kind of a sculpture, assemblage. Joseph Cornell is an artist that my mum has always loved, and he creates these boxes as works of art. So things like this. Using sort of found objects and they're really beautiful works of art, and I like the idea of it telling a story, you know, being able to read into it without reading. I mean, I just read you that little write-up, but essentially we wanted the album to speak for itself, so you open it up and the actual images show you the story. This is more Joseph Cornell. And ours, those were the two boxes that we created. It's not the highest res image, I'm afraid, but you get the gist. So the two sides of the boxes are going to tell slightly different stories. The left-hand side is more about looking into the past. So you remember the journals that I showed you earlier, my dad's journals when he was traveling. The newspaper in the background is one that you actually see. Do you remember the little alligator there that was on the cover of the newspaper? That's actually that newspaper opened out as the backing. The passport here was on the bottom left. That's my granddad's passport, which was lost in a shipwreck, and he survived a shipwreck, and he managed to salvage his passport, and it's still got the marks from where it got wet. It's all crinkled up. And there's symbolic things like the black beans here. There's a Brazilian staple dish is black bean stew. You've got the cassettes here, which are the original cassettes that my dad used to play of Paulinho da Viola and Chico Buarque, which I grew up listening to. And this reel of tape has actually got my auntie's name on it. I don't even know what's on the reel of tape. It's probably the family playing music together, because the Glass family used to play music together. Anyway, so it was one thing I wanted to say about this is that I've talked quite a lot about creative block this last sort of week or so, because I've been teaching Project Evolution, one of the newer modules with the EMP Year 2 guys. And breaking creative block is really, I'm really interested in ways of breaking creative block. And we reached a point around the time that we started making these boxes where we got saturated by the project, you know, and we just had enough, and we're overthinking, you know, you can start overthinking things and it just doesn't help creativity and productivity. So we decided to make this, and it just broke the deadlock somehow, because we were, you know, we were dealing with 3D objects and not listening, not looking at screens or listening to sounds. We were representing it in a kind of a 3D physical way, and that's how we came up with the inlay. And you've got photographs of all of the musicians. We really wanted to make sure everyone was credited, so all of the musicians are there, and all of the photographers are also credited. And these are just photos that I took that photograph, Léon de Judas, Lion of Judah, so you have the link there with Rastafarianism. That was taken on a boat in Ile Grande on an island, and a street scene from the carnival. And that's our visual concept. The other nice idea which the graphic designer came up with was, because it's a double album with two discs, he coloured the four blocks according to what number side it was, you know, A, B, C or D. So if you look at this one here, you know that's side C, which is the first side of disc two. Just little touches like that, and the attention to detail that really like helped make it a bit more special. The next thing I wanted to show you is how we launched the album. We got a film produced, and this is the film. So we launched it as a kind of a teaser. That was our promo vid. It was a nice way of giving a flavour of the track without giving away the whole album, if that makes sense. And that's us at the launch party, Russ B, me and Strider. The whole thing was kind of, even though it ended up being quite a lavish package, you know, that visually and in terms of the product, the whole thing was quite a sort of a homegrown affair. So we held a small launch party in a record shop in Bristol, and invited friends and family. One of the big challenges was actually releasing the album, and it's quite crazy how things went. The guy who mastered it from Star Delta in Devon is called Lewis, and he's an incredible mastering engineer, and he stem mastered the whole album. So the reason you saw that Logic project as it was is that this is what we provided the mastering engineer with stems. which he was able to manipulate a lot more and sort of get into the DNA of the individual's parts. And Lewis was so, he offered to help us find a label to release the album. And he had a few specific labels that he had in mind. And he said, I really think you need to, I think people are going to really like this. And it wasn't the right time. Everyone, he sent it to about three different labels, and we were really excited. And he said he was positive that one of them was going to jump on it. And it wasn't the right time. One of the labels said, if this was this time last year, I would have jumped on this. But we've just got this schedule of blah, 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 blah. And in the end, Matt, a guy from Unearthed Record Distribution, ended up saying that he wanted to put it out. So they paid for all of the costs of the album. We didn't spend anything on the whole thing, apart from all of the days and days of recording, obviously, the studio and the session musician fees and so on. But in terms of the manufacturing, he also believed in the project so much that he went for it, and he didn't cut any corners. We wanted it to be gatefold and so on. And it worked out in the end, but we had kind of big hopes for it that a label would jump on it and so on. And it ended up being a lot more satisfying us putting it out on our own label. So we set up our own label called Rastrumentals. And since then we've released remixes of the tracks on this album as 12 inches, or 10 inches rather. It's a very tricky thing to do. You might find that some projects you do are, you know, you do them with integrity and maybe to do something a bit different, but you won't get the same reaction as if you were putting out something a little bit more orthodox in one genre. And that's, you know, it's not a bad thing, it's not a good thing, it's just an eye-opener. Every project has a different kind of response, you know, and you never really quite know what it's going to be like. When we put out Victory, for example, we had absolutely no plan on it being a big tune. It just happened to be tick the right boxes and so on. I always try and give these top tips. This is from like many years of like making mistakes or learning from my errors, or maybe reflection on how I've handled things or strategies and things like that. I've tried to get some top tips as to how to navigate the music world. So the first one is, be nice to people and help them out on your way. So, you know, you never know when you're going to come across people again, collaborate with people again. And if you can be kind to people, and that by being kind, I mean, help people out, but don't do it expecting something in return, you know. And some of these tips are going to sound obvious, but this is what I would say. Doing favors for other people. When I do a favor for somebody else, I don't do a favor with a kind of a IOU bank of favors. I'm just trying to help somebody out, because that's my number one tip. Work hard, but be kind to yourself. So, you know, when you're really into a project and you're passionate about what you do, you can just burn the candle at both ends and just go in so hard that you end up practically spending all your time doing your project. And there's something great about that, because you just get completely immersed in it and you can be super creative. But after a while, you burn out, you know. So I know a lot of people who have become really successful, especially as DJs / producers, and they will have a boom and they will just go in really, really hard and do gigging, probably drinking a lot and etc. And then after a few years they burn out, you know, and I'll see the same person, I haven't seen them for a few years, and they've aged sort of 15 years in 2 years. And that's a reality, you know, and that's what happens. It's very easy for that to happen without you realizing it. So, you know, looking after yourself, drinking water, eating healthy food, trying to get exercise and spiritual well-being, mindfulness, meditation, all of those things will do you huge favors if you try to embed them as well. I try, I don't always manage to, but it's, you know, I'm 43 now, and that means I've got a lot more to deal with. Lots of tiring things, like having two small children and trying to be an artist and gig and tour and stuff like that. It's very, very tiring, and you need to know your parameters and your limits as to what you can do, you know, what's too much and what's the right amount. So work hard, but be kind to yourself. Challenge yourself, you know, don't stick within your tried and tested zone. Go outside of that. You might hate a certain genre, but maybe that, I mean, when I was at university, I did a module about international and cross-cultural styles. And one of the options was a Brazilian music group. And obviously I was wanted to go to that one because I was also always been to Brazilian music. But somebody else jumped ahead of me, this girl, and she signed up the last space on the Brazilian group. So no Brazilian group for me. And the only one that was left over was country and Western. So I was in the country and Western group, much to my dismay. But funnily enough, that was the best grade I got out of all of my modules at university, was that particular module, specifically because I had to go completely out of my comfort zone and make something new out of something which my initial reaction was maybe, I mean, sometimes it's snobbery. Sometimes we have prejudices, you know, musical prejudices ourselves about genres or artists, and it's very important to keep that in check. Listen widely. So the same type of idea, really. Make sure you listen to as many other genres as possible. And you know, the lots of the greatest musicians and producers I've met have been the most diverse listeners. So, you know, you might meet somebody who's, I don't know, a reggae legend, but actually they listen to African music all the time, or they listen to electronic music, or something completely unrelated to the genre of music they make, you know, and that's great because it enriches you a lot. And welcome criticism and reflect on it. That's how we can up our game, you know. I remember when I was starting out, I got some criticism from a guy called Disciples, Russ Disciples, who's a legendary UK dub producer. And we were putting out our first record, and he said, I was hoping for some feedback about the pre-master before putting it out. And he came back with some kind of quite sort of like heavy criticism, kind of slated it a little bit, really. He said that the drums sounded pretty weak and that the percussion sound didn't really add anything to it. And, you know, I could go on. He made numerous points like that. And my initial reaction was like, I was really upset and annoyed and just felt that's not fair. But actually, you know, on hindsight, I went away and I did all of the stuff that he said and improved it. And he ended up doing a remix of it in the end. And it was a good release. But on hindsight, I remember looking back and seeing everything that he'd said to me was absolutely on point. All of his criticism was on point. And he was right about it all, you know. And so I just always remember that time of you know, it's how important it is to open yourself up to that and to appreciate other people's views. But I think most of you are good at that anyway. You have to be, don't you? In this game, you have to be able to take it on the nose if somebody makes a less positive comment about your music. And finally, yeah, keep on improving your game and raising the bar regardless of experience. So even if you're established as an artist, let's say maybe you've got a record deal, if you speak to like the truly great musicians, a couple of things that you notice about them is often they are extremely humble, surprisingly. And I don't mean rock stars, I mean the truly great musicians, people that have made a huge difference in the history of music. Like Tom Jobim, the guy who invented bossa nova. He is somebody who would learn from a street performer. He was open to learning. So a five-year-old kid could come along and scraping a plate, let's say, and he would learn something from that and appreciate that, even if you played something and you'd only been studying guitar for a year, it's being open and not closed to new, improving yourself and increasing your skills and so on. There isn't really a people have this idea about hierarchy. And I do talk about, I talk about this quite a lot in lessons, that there is a bit of an illusion that you have the big people, the big players up here, and then you have the kind of bedroom producers down here. And what you want to do is make it so that you're up here in the big league. But actually, the difference between, you know, the talent and the artistic significance and importance and, you know, the originality of these two kind of bands is not, is, there isn't really any difference. It doesn't mean that these people up here are, they've just had a really successful tune, or they've got the right angle or the right marketing, or a record label has injected loads of money into their name and boom, they're up there. And the people down here, let's say, you know, bedroom producers or up and coming producers or people that are setting up their own record label, they view that as the ultimate. But actually the models change. You know, it used to be, the goal used to be getting a record deal with a major label. That was the, you know, that was the pièce de résistance. That was the ultimate goal. But now actually, I mean, speaking to people I know, friends of mine who have had major label deals, I know two people that have. One of them was in a rock band, a massive rock band. I can't remember the name, ironically. But actually, it's not ironic because he was hugely successful and they toured the world and they were paid to record albums and he did it all, the whole shebang. And then they went out of favor or they were out of fashion and record company dropped them. And now my friend, he's living in a small Welsh village running an open mic night. And he's happy, you know, that's great. And he's happier now probably than he was then. But that's what I'm saying is that, you know, it can be very momentary, that perceived success. Another friend of mine had a signed deal and then he's now a primary school teacher. That didn't work out. So, you know, if you want to do things your way, do things your way, and try to destroy this idea, this hierarchy of like, they've made it, they've smashed it, because you've probably got a lot more to offer than a lot of the big players do. You know, you've probably got a lot more originality or individual skills or individuality than a lot of the big players, so-called big players. So I would say believe in yourself and don't stop doing what you're doing, you know. So that's why I never stopped doing this genre of music, even for, you know, decades or years and years and years. It wasn't trendy. You couldn't sell any records in that genre. I just kept doing it because I wanted to do it. So I would urge you to stick with what you love and don't just bend to whatever genre is in fashion, you know. And it's very easy to do that, especially in electronica, where new trends come out all the time. You know, it goes from one BPM to another BPM or 4 to the floor, or, you know, that type of molding of styles. Stick to the styles that you love and focus in on that and home in on that and amplify that into something massive, you know. Anyway, so I'm going to say thank you for having me. Much appreciated. I hope you can take something away from this and implement it in your own workflow and just keep hold of that enthusiasm and that passion, that excitement. Even when you think you've lost it, try to go back to what got you excited. Like I used to get excited about the synthesizer and stuff, and that raw passion and excitement, no money can buy that, you know. If you've got that feeling, you know, hold on to it and galvanize it, because it's a very, very special thing. And that's what makes a little idea turn into a big idea, and having that determination. So just keep going. And anyway, I'm around here all the time anyway. I'm around here Tuesdays and Thursdays. So if you ever see me and you want to chat to me, I'm always around. I'm part of DBS. So, and I'd love to chat to you guys anytime you want to. So I'm going to play some music. And I'd like to say thank you again for coming. I'm much appreciated. And I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you. So thanks for watching my masterclass. I hope you enjoyed it. Check out more videos at DBS's YouTube channel. Thanks for watching.